This is Sports Talk with Phil Kornblut and Chris Bergen. Sports Talk is heard across the state on radio affiliates of the Sports Talk Media Network and is streaming live on SportsTalkSC.com, as well as Twitter, Facebook, and YouTube. The South Carolina Education Lottery lucky number to call in is 888-898-2525. That's 888-898-2525. Now, here are Phil and Chris with tonight's edition of Sports Talk.
All right, welcome in. Welcome into Sports Talk on a Monday. Beautiful Monday in South Carolina. Glad you're with us. Hope you had a great weekend. Back from Raleigh, I am. Back from Clemson, Chris Bergen is. And sitting right here where we left him last week, Josh Cohen in Columbia. All right, phone number, 888-898-2525. 888-898-2525. South Carolina Education Lottery. Lucky number into Sports Talk, and we're not going to take too much time. You know the news. We want to hear from you. Kendall Rogers of D1 Baseball will join us at 7:05 to give a national perspective on the change at South Carolina. Jim Thoman, just a bit outside, will join us at 7:35 to give a more inside look at the change at South Carolina. So, South Carolina making the change after 7 years of Mark Kingston. I know that a number, I don't know if it's a large number, small number, a loud number, but a number. Gamecock fans were pushing for this. Radio shows, message boards, any place they could share their opinion. Just didn't think that Mark Kingston was going to take the program to a high enough level after 7 years. And apparently, Ray Tanner must have felt the same way. John Whittle broke the story from the Big Spur this morning that the change was forthcoming. USC soon thereafter put out the official release. You know, my thought is I thought it would be a tough decision. Maybe it wasn't a tough decision. He made it, you know, pretty quickly after the end of the weekend, after the Gamecocks were eliminated from the regional. And so Tanner may have had it already in his mind that this was going to happen, or if they did not advance to a super, he was going to do it, et cetera, et cetera. I do not believe the Kingston era was a disaster by any means. Four regionals out of 6 years and two supers. But, yes, I get it. The Gamecock baseball program is held at a high level with two national championships and all those appearances in the College World Series and appearances in national championship games. And more is expected. And maybe, Chris, it became apparent throughout this year that Kingston was just not going to be able to get to that next level. You watch this season play out, and it was a very, you know, they kind of won despite themselves. This was a team that never seemed to really have a set pitching rotation, never seemed to have a set bullpen. They were always piecing in a starter here, piecing in a closer there. They had a couple of injuries, of course, that were an issue. But, you know, the lineup was always moving between an offensive lineup or a defensive lineup. It just seemed like, you know, for a program that should be more established, that they never could get established with this team. Yet, they won 37 games, matching the second most under Kingston, 42 last year, 37 this year. And they made the postseason. They made a strong run of the SEC tournament. So there were those positives. And I got to believe that for Ray Tanner, this could not have been an absolutely easy decision, because you got a program that's kind of right there, but not able to break through that glass ceiling, I guess you could say.
And I'm wondering too, Phil, if having a former baseball coach as your athletics director probably played against Mark Kingston coming back for another season, because Ray Tanner did what we all did, sat and watched this baseball team throughout the season, and despite the wins, you summed it up perfectly. They won in spite of themselves. I mean, just fundamentally flawed throughout the year, whether it be at home plate and taking bad swings and striking out too much, or their inability to remember you have to step on second base to try and turn a double play. Can't throw it from third to first. I mean, you can't watch that team this year and think that was a good baseball team, because they were so fundamentally flawed. And then you start sizing up their wins. All right, so they did have a nice series victory against Kentucky, and I think that's a solid, solid series win. They, you know, ultimately matched wits with Arkansas, but then you look back, they swept Vanderbilt. How good's Vandy? They won two out of three against Florida. How good of Florida? They barely got into the NCAA tournament. Probably should not have gotten in, even though they're now going to a super regional after winning over Oklahoma State earlier today.
Unbelievable. Not only are they going to a super regional, they're coming to the Clemson super regional. Do you think Clemson's pretty happy about that?
I don't know. Do you want a former Clemson coach in the other dugout handling a team that's maybe starting to peak at the right time?
Well, they just had one there last weekend, and he made a quick 0-2 exit.
This is true.
You know, what does all that mean? You know, that goes out the window. I mean, again, Jack Leggett's going to see an old buddy, and Eric Backich is going to see an old buddy across the way. But hey, that's put to the side when these guys are trying to earn a spot in Omaha.
And Clemson never got to see Tim Corbin other than watching games. They never even met each other this weekend. But back to USC, and I'm not sure it was that difficult a decision for Ray Tanner. And even if he was on the fence about possibly bringing Mark Kingston back, I think Kingston may have sealed his own fate with his comments yesterday after their loss to James Madison when he talked about you can't view a season in which you made the NCAA tournament out of the SEC as a failure. Coach, 11 teams out of the SEC got in. I mean, it's almost like they invited the entire league almost. I'm surprised they didn't. It was not a major accomplishment if you're in the SEC that you made the NCAA tournament, and Gamecock fans want more. And I think that's his biggest problem is he lost the fan base. I mean, they had gone from excited about him, well, let's see what he can do, then angry because he's not consistently getting to the super regionals and back to Omaha. And then I think you got to the worst parts. And when you lose the fan base and there's apathy in the fan base and they don't care anymore, and you can see it in some of the attendance figures for home games throughout the season, I think that was probably just too much to bring him back, and I think it's probably time. And I hate any time a coach gets fired. It's not a good day. It's not a day to jump up and down and be excited about it because families are affected. There are going to be a lot of families that are affected by this move, but I think it probably was time. I mean, Chad Holbrook did – probably even a little bit better in a short amount of time. And he was cut loose after 5 years. So Kingston had long enough to prove that he could be the guy. And I just don't think he ever quite understood what he had gotten himself into. And I'm not surprised Ray Tanner made the move today. I am surprised he made it as quickly as he did. But my guess is he had already had that made up in his mind. If USC didn't go to a super regional, he was probably going to pull the trigger.
Of course, he wasn't going to make it too soon because, well, they were still playing. I get that. He could have fired him at any time when things were going poorly. But by waiting until June 1st, the buyout went from $800,000 to $400,000. So he saved $400,000. Mm-hmm. But again, I know they still had to finish out the season. It just sort of worked out that way for him. So Kingston is going out the front door. The question is who comes in the back door. Imani Lee will serve as the interim head coach. And, of course, a lot of people who think just give it to Monty. You know, he was on the staff, and he's very popular, and Ray knows him well, and been a head coach and very successful coach at College of Charleston and successful coach at Clemson. Though Tiger fans will tell you he wasn't successful enough, and he got fired by Dan Radakovich for pretty much the same reasons that Kingston got fired by Ray Tanner. Didn't win big enough, didn't get out of a regional, didn't get to a super regional. You know, in Kingston's case, at least he got to two super regionals. But Monty Lee would be certainly a candidate for sure. Of course, Landon Powell's name will be talked about. And will Ray Tanner talk to one of his all-time great players who's doing a fantastic job at North Greenville? Can you hire a guy to coach at South Carolina who's only coached at the D2 level? Certainly he knows his baseball, and he has his legacy at South Carolina. But that, too, has to be considered. And then, of course, I would say if you're South Carolina, with your tradition, with your history, that if you're willing to pony up, you can get pretty much anybody in the country. No, you're not going to steal the coach from Arkansas or Texas A&M. I don't think Corbin would come from Vanderbilt. They're just spending a ton of money on their facility there in Nashville, so I don't think he's going to leave that. And he didn't have a great year this year. I'm sure he wants to try to have a bounce back year. O'Sullivan at Florida, that name comes up. I don't think that's going to happen either. Because look, he's got a chance to get back to Omaha where he is. He's got a beautiful new facility. They pay him a ton of money, but there are other very successful coaches at programs that aren't at that level that you perhaps could go out and lure with a good payday. They were paying Kingston, what was it, $725 a year? So they'd have to, you know, probably come off the hip a good bit more to for the next guy, whoever that happens to be, if it's a highly successful major college coach. I mean, you throw out the coach's name at Wake Forest. You throw out the coach's name at Duke. You know, they've had very good runs. Maybe you look at the coach at Virginia. I mean, I'm just throwing out programs here that have been very successful that are in this area that you might take a look at. So,
I think another name you need to throw in there, Phil, and I like his energy, is Cliff Godwin at East Carolina. And I know he's a Pirate alum and played there and did, has done wonderful things with that program, but he may be to the point something Gary Gilmore touched on last night about how the NIL situation has gotten so out of hand that it's nearly impossible for a mid-major, if you will, to get to Omaha and do what Coastal did back in 2016. Cliff Godwin, Godwin may be looking at that same situation out at ECU since they got bounced today as well and thinking, you know what, I've done probably all I can do here. Maybe it's time to take my talents to the next level.
Yeah, but then again, and I hear you, and he's a very good coach and a very successful coach, but they carry the stigma of being the program in the country with the most NCAA tournament appearances never to make it to Omaha.
Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, they get into the tournament, you know, because they're good in their area and they're good in their league, and they host a lot of regionals, but they don't advance very often. So, I mean, when South Carolina went to their first Super under Kingston, they went through Greenville, North Carolina to get there. Not saying he's not a really good coach and not saying that's a name that you shouldn't consider. I'm just saying the public reaction would be, well, you know, had, has he done any more at East Carolina than Kingston did at South Carolina? You know, and he's been there a lot longer.
Yeah, but it's like, it's in my opinion, I hear everything you're saying, but it's like he's driving a Ford and you've got Mark Kingston sitting over there in a Porsche. Well, Mark Kingston should always win that race, right?
Well, is it a Porsche, though?
If you give Cliff Godwin a Porsche, how does he do?
But I was, you know, I was talking to someone today who said, you heard what Kingston said in his post game yesterday about South Carolina needing to kind of step up in the NIL space and do more. And, and somebody was telling me that they're not all that competitive in the NIL space right now in baseball. And that, you know, in the minds of the coaching staff, the minds of the head coach, mind of the head coach, more needed to be done in that area to help them when they go into the transfer portal, John, to buy players.
Right.
You know, they need more. So where do you get more? I guess you get more from the fans who are screaming about win more. Well, give more, I guess.
Exactly.
I mean, it goes round and round. So, look, I mean, it was not a fabulous era under a Kingston, you know, from a record standpoint and the failure to get to Omaha in six seasons. But it was not a disaster. And, you know, I don't think the program is any less than it was when he took it over from Chad Holbrook. This is, you know, it's right about where it was when Chad took it over. I mean, when Mark took it over from Chad, I think it's right about where it was, which tells you how hard it is to follow Ray Tanner and what he built. And Ray Tanner's 0-for-2 in trying to find somebody to win like he did. And so I don't know who that person is that's going to be able to win like he did.
And I'm not sure he'll ever be able to find that person, Phil, because and you look around the country. I mean, I watch Evansville win that regional in Greenville, North Carolina today. I saw High Point, a team that had never been to the NCAA tournament. They won a game. They knocked Vanderbilt out of the Clemson regional. You have Wofford getting into the tournament and winning a game. I think the resources that are being allocated now to college baseball, it's spread much, much greater than it ever was back in the early 2000s, certainly in the 2010s. And I think it's much more difficult to be as dominant, and that's the only way you can phrase it, as dominant as Carolina baseball was when they made three consecutive trips to Omaha. I'm not sure we're going to ever see that again because the landscape of the game has changed so much that everybody is getting competitive because they feel like they can win at college baseball, even at a place like East Carolina, even at a place like Evansville.
How do you explain Arkansas losing?
That great point.
In their regional.
I don't. I have no idea how that happened.
Yeah. I mean, are they going to fire the coach there? Now, I know, you know, they were number one in the country some this year. And look, South Carolina, and that's the strange thing about this South Carolina team. They had a number of impressive wins on their resume against top five, top ten competition. And they played some of their best baseball down the stretch of the season in the SEC tournament. But, you know, they could not overcome themselves when you add it all up and you look at the number of errors they made over their last 10 games. Well, let's see, over their last they went 3-2, and then they played they went 3-2, that's five games, and then they went 1-2. So over their last eight games, the number of errors they committed, unbelievable. The number of double plays they hit into, the number of base running errors that they made, just fundamentally fell apart for whatever reason over those last eight games. Yet, you know, they won three in Hoover, and they won that first game against James Madison, had a close game, you know, with NC State. You could say that it was right there for them to win that game. They had a chance to win that game against NC State and had multiple opportunities to win that game yesterday. You know, third base, runner on third, nobody out, can't get the run home. Had two critical replays go against them that really stifled scoring opportunities for them. Not saying they weren't correct calls on the replays. I'm just saying that they went against the Gamecocks this time. So, you know, those things all added up to a shorter stay. And they might not have been able to beat NC State with whatever they had left to pitch. They probably would have had Roman Kimball ready to go tomorrow night. I would imagine he would have been the starter tomorrow night. Last night, had they faced NC State in that that game, that Sunday night game, I imagine that's who they would have started. And he might have been ready, and, you know, he pitched well his last time out. But anyway, that is water over the dam because it never got to that for the Gamecocks. So we're going to talk more about that and take your phone calls in just a second. And we mentioned these regionals today. Evansville did beat East Carolina 6-5 in Greenville, North Carolina, to advance to the Super Regional round. And in this game, Evansville took the early lead, fell behind, then scored three runs in the sixth and shut out the Pirates the rest of the way to win it 6-5. And then you got Florida winning at Oklahoma State. Now, this is a stunner. This is a team that we all picked on for getting into the tournament with a 28-27 record. And here they are winning the doggone regional 4-2.
Still doesn't mean they should have been there.
Well,
you know, it's like teams that, you know, go 6-6 and, or, you know, when we get into football season and conferences brag about how well they do in the postseason, it doesn't reflect, you know, a month off. It doesn't reflect what you did during the regular season. Same thing here with Florida. It still doesn't mean that because they got to the Supers, it still doesn't mean that they should have been in the tournament.
No, but they're making the best of it.
Yeah, there's no doubt about that.
They're making the best of it. So now we're waiting to find out a day and a time on the Clemson-Florida Super Regional. I was told earlier this morning most likely Clemson would be playing on Friday afternoon with no time at that particular point being available. But we'll see if that comes to fruition. But that's what I was told was the word that they were hearing. I guess they're going to wait till after these two games tonight are finished to determine everything. Oregon State won their regional 11-6 over Irvine. Top of the first, North Carolina and LSU are scoreless in Chapel Hill. And the last one is Connecticut and Oklahoma. Okay.
Got an update. North Carolina actually scored two in the first. They lead 2-0 in the bottom of the first now.
All right. So with that said, and we got other notes, and of course it was a big recruiting weekend. We got a long, meaty, juicy, prime rib-like recruiting report to bring your way. So stay tuned for that. Yeah. It's a prime rib Monday night recruiting report. Plus Kendall Rogers and Coach Jim Thoman. Okay? Oh, and some post-game from Clemson and Coastal,
yes.
Time permitting. Oh, we must say, again, and we'll get him back on with us this week if he's not already on an island somewhere, Gary Gilmore, terrific career, as we've already talked about. What a great effort they gave at Clemson. It was moving to watch the end of that game and see the handshake line between the Coastal coaches and the Clemson coaches, especially the long hug between Gilmore and Jack Leggett. I'd love to know what they were saying to one another, and we'll try to find that out when we can. But I just thought that was, it was very touching. It was very touching to see two great warriors who had many, many battles against one another over their years as coaches, and their respect. That's all you want, right? At the end of the day, the money's fine and the championships are fine. All you want's just a little damn bit of respect.
You know what Gilly said last night, and all of his comments are up on our website at sportstalksc.com, but I thought this was really, really fascinating. He talked about when they won in 2016, and he said the coolest part of that and the thing that I'll always take aside from the victory itself was the fact that we had Clemson fans pulling for us and Gamecock fans pulling for us, and it was the one time in our state that we were all one. And I thought, you know what, that's spot on.
You know, I got a feeling there might have been a Gamecock fan or two that has a bug up their rear about Coastal that was not pulling for Coastal.
Fair enough. Maybe he didn't hear from maybe him one anyway.
By the way, I hope we're not scaring too many people on our stream because Josh has got this new funky camera that he's using. It's like my face just takes up the whole screen. I think we need, is there a way to back that? It's scaring me to be that have a head face that
there
big.
There we go. How's that? Now we can get all of corn.
There we go. Without, I want. Can you just shoot from the turkey neck up? And that'll work. The double chin. Get the double. There you go. Double chin. Gamecocks have double plays, and we broadcasters have a double chin. Okay, let's go to the phones. 888-898-2525 is the number. We'll get that figured out. Gamecock Larry is with us now, and Gamecock Larry, Gamecock Sports. Come to an end on Sunday. It's all over. Now you got to rest up for football season.
Hot diggity damn. Thank you, ma'am. He's gone. Gone, gone, gone. I tell you what, 7 years ago, I said, Mark, who? Where'd he come from? Lord, I don't think he's going to last very long. I told them that on the radio. They wouldn't listen to me. I told him like it was for about 7 years. And I told him when they hired Monty Lee, I said, Kingston has done hired his replacement. Both of them came true. He didn't last, and then Monty Lee is the interim coach. Now we're going to go out. We're going to get us a top-notch coach. We're going to pay him top-notch money. And we're going to be in the World College World Series. Old Gamecock Larry may not be around. Mm. In 2026, we will be in the College World Series.
Whoa.
Yes.
2026?
Yes, sir.
2026?
Yeah, well.
What about 2025? Yes, sir, what about 2025?
Well, 2025, that's just getting a. I'm going to tell you something about what y'all told me about what y'all said a while ago. I'm going to tell you what happened. But 2025 is just a year to get used to what's going to happen, just to build it up. Now, you say Kingston took us to two super regionals? Kingston went to Super Regional in Arkansas with Holbrook recruits, Holbrook players, Holbrook, and they knew how to play Gamecock baseball, and that's why he went to the Super Regional at Arkansas. Now, another thing, they asked
Wait a minute, Larry. To be fair, what players did he have last year when he got to the Supers?
Well, I tell you what, I don't know. One time out of 7 years.
Larry,
man, let me tell you something. We
got to go. We're out of time in this segment. We'll hit you back tomorrow night. We'll talk more about it. Be back after this break. Don't go away. So, you know, I kind of enjoyed my trip up to Raleigh, up on Tobacco Road. I will say one thing North Carolina has over South Carolina, is their arrangement of those major colleges. You got three of them within 30 miles of each other. If you're a sports fan, that's just heaven. That's just absolute heaven. And it's a shame the ACC is just dissolving in front of our very eyes. And, you know, they've, of course, messed with the rivalries there on Tobacco Road because they've reduced a number of games they're playing against one another. And that's just absolutely ridiculous. But, you know, I made a quick trip. I was in Durham. I have some family in Durham, so I visited. Then I rode over to the Duke campus. I was hoping to absorb some of the brain cells that were floating around. So I think I did, but then I went back to the NC State campus and they got neutralized. So
yeah, Raleigh will do that to you.
There's a lot
of stupidity in Raleigh, North Carolina.
Including Alan Smothers, who I never saw.
No, I wasn't talking Our about Alan. Friend. I'm talking about the state capitol.
I'll take you to dinner. Okay, Alan. Never saw him again after we walked in on Friday afternoon. Never saw him again. Never heard from him again. I don't know if he got kidnapped or ran off somewhere or, you know, went jumping around with the Wolfpack players and all that kind of stuff. Anyway, had a good time. It's an interesting area for sure. The Triangle Research Park area. Went driving through there. My gosh, have they got one huge industry after another, major company after another, all through there. So pretty interesting part of the country. But glad to be back in good old South Kalalaki. All right, phone number 888-898-2525. Clemson and Florida. We're going to play in the Super Regional beginning maybe Friday. And we'll see. Is this Clemson's year? I mean, they're catching a break because, I mean, you're getting a team that barely got into the tournament. Mm-hmm. But somehow managed to win on the road. You got to give Florida credit. To go to Oklahoma State and win, you got to give them some credit. We'll find out more about them from Kendall Rogers at 7:05. Jim Toman, 7:35. We go to Andy in Columbia for our next phone call. Andy, welcome in. How are you?
I'm doing well, thank you. First off, I want to congratulate the straw man for having his number put up in Citi Field, retiring number 18. That's part of my Saturday.
Were the foul line still there once he went through the ballpark?
Well, you know, the dock was there.
So I'm saying, one line for each.
Between him and the dock, you know, the straw man.
That's just mean.
But, you know, you got the dock and the straw man's number side by side.
Mm-hmm. It's not exactly Ruth and Garrick, but okay. It's not exactly Ruth, Garrick, and Mantle Yogi Berra and, you know,
I can continue,
but that's fine.
New was established in 1960, we'll take it.
Okay. You can have it.
Okay. Now, let's get to the most important part. As my favorite band would sing, he's gone, and nothing's going to bring him back. Praise the Lord. Mm. I'll tell you, when a man can sit up there and say that he thinks it's a successful season with 25 losses, only 13 wins in your conference when you play 30 games. Then, Korn, if you want to talk about the end of the season, they went 4-10 in their last 14 games. So how is that a successful end of a season? Okay? So don't blow smoke up our poops, okay? Because the man got what he deserved, okay? He got shown the door. And thank you, Ray Tanner, for finally stepping up and doing the right thing. Now, you know how I feel about Landon Powell. Hopefully he's going to be the man who comes in. I know a lot of people don't know if a Division II coach would come in and be the coach who can take over an SEC program. But if you can have Monty Lee being next to him as his bench coach that can kind of help him along, bring him along in that area, that might be a good fit.
Now, Monty might be headed to the Citadel. Monty might be headed out of town.
Well, someone who I don't think would be a good fit is someone who you just said who coaches the Citadel and played at the Citadel, who we went after before, and that's Mr. McDonald up at Louisville. I don't think he'd be a good fit here. I think that he's a little bit older. I don't think that his teams are what they were, and I don't think that's who we should bring in. If we don't bring in a Landon Powell, the person I would like to see us bring in would be Pollard from Duke. I think he's a very good coach, younger coach, upcoming coach. And if you can do what you did at Duke, can you imagine what you can do at South Carolina with the facilities and the tradition that we have here and playing in the SEC? And I think he'd be a very good second choice on my man, Landon Powell. But you know how I feel about Landon Powell. I've been going for, been kind of pushing for him for the past few years. But I'm just happy. And, you know, his press conference the other day, Kingston, just shows that he wasn't the right coach for South Carolina. To say that this was a successful season is just a slap in our faces. 25 losses. Do you realize the man was, what, 13 or 16 games below 500 in SEC play?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, that's unacceptable. I'm sorry. He had, what, 26 losses in one of his seasons and then 25 again this year? We were just barely, what, 60 games over 500? This program a decade ago was, I believe, the second highest winning percentage in college baseball. Okay?
I'm not disagreeing with you. I think 7 years is a good run, six competitive seasons, and total of seven. So I think he had ample opportunity to build the Gamecocks into a national power and get to Omaha a couple of times at least. So, yeah, I don't disagree with you, and I don't really disagree with the decision here by Ray Tanner, because I think 7 years is enough time to, sure, to show what you can do. Most coaches get about
and
five.
And Mr. Korn,
they got seven with six seasons. Again, in Kingston's defense, yeah, I know the SEC numbers aren't great. I thought he did a good enough job where the program didn't sink. Okay, it's not like it's worse than it was when he took it over.
Treading
water is probably a good way to put it.
And that's not anything anybody wants to do. Treading water is about ready to drown. And Korn, don't forget, you owe me. You lost the bet. Okay.
Yeah, but I mean, like, didn't you owe me going in?
No, we were even, and this was the we.
All right, well, let's bet on the NBA Finals. I'll take the Celtics.
Oh, I'm sure you will. I'm sure you will.
You know, by the way, and we got to run.
But you know what, Korn?
What?
I'll take Dallas because I know you're never going to pay me up on this bet anyway.
All right, take Dallas.
So,
yeah.
It doesn't matter.
This,
we might as well just keep it going.
This has a very good chance, and thanks for the phone call. This has a very good chance, Chris and Josh, to be the year of the corn. It's been my dream. I think it may have happened back in the 60s. I could go back and look. But it's been my adult dream to have the Celtics, Yankees and Packers all champions in the same athletic year, more or less.
All right, you're going to have to lay out the reasons you believe the Packers will be the best team in the NFC this going.
Well, I think they got a chance. I mean, Jordan Love's going to be superb. Maybe have a better running game. I hate losing Aaron Jones, but we got picked up a very good running back in Jacobs. He's a really good running back. Plus, they say A.J. Dillon. I saw some video of A.J. Dillon in off-season workouts, and he looks like a hunk of a man, just a hunk of a man. All those young receivers, we got really one of the best receiving cores in the NFL, and they're all growing up together at the same time and getting better and better. Improvement on the offensive line with some young draft picks. Signed a big-time safety off of free agency to help us in the secondary. A lot of reasons. A kicker who won't miss a field goal that, you know, he should have made against the Lions, and we would have beat the Lions, and we would have gone to play for the NFC Championship last year. So, we'd have beat the Lions. Yeah, we'd have beat you. So, I got real. My point is, you know, the Yankees are the best team in baseball. The Celtics are the best team in basketball. And then the Packers, I think, are going to make a strong run. It could be the year of the corn. And I will celebrate that heartily if indeed it happens.
I'm sure you will. I think the bigger concern I'd have is the Yankees. Of course, Celtics, Mavs, we might actually get decent NBA playoff games now that we've gotten to the finals.
Yeah.
Because the lead up has just been garbage.
Yeah. I don't want it to be too decent. I don't want it to be too tight, you know. But look, the Mavs have got a couple of great players, a couple of Hall of Famers that can score big, but the Celtics also have guys that can counter that. So we'll see what happens. All right, let's get back to the phones. Folks are waiting. 888-898-2525. Jamie in Hilton Head, you're up next on Sports Talk. Welcome in.
Well, good evening. Good evening. It's kind of a mixed day. You know, I've always been a Clemson fan, so I'm very happy with my Tigers.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm a baseball fan for the state of South Carolina. And first of all, I really want to say congratulations and thank you to Coach Gilmore for all he's done for the game of college baseball. You'll be missed. Enjoy your retirement, Coach. You know, just thank you. And I want to give you a name for South Carolina. I mean, I know that you all love Landon Powell, and you should, but I don't think you can hire him right now. I just don't think he's got enough experience. Remember now, and I mean, I don't mean this in a negative way. Remember now, y'all are South Carolina. For a long time, y'all were the elite program in college baseball, okay? And I just think that you deserve more than that. I mean, put Landon Powell on staff. Let him come be the hitting coach for a while. But I would look at Dan McDonald of Louisville. Y'all deserve a big-name coach because you're a big-name program. And I think it's time for Tanner to pony up some money and get you a big-name coach. Now, listen to me now. I'm thinking out of the box.
Mm-hmm.
Who in the world says, because it's been done before, what about if Ray Tanner was to get back in the dugout?
Well, that ain't going to happen. So don't even think it.
Why? I mean, really, why?
Because, in all seriousness, come on. He's very close to retirement himself as the AD. The aggravation of going back into – it's a young man's game now. I mean, it's – you got to have a young man's approach to it with this NIL and the transfer portal, and he has no experience from a coaching standpoint in dealing with those two aspects. So it makes so many older coaches get out of it now. They don't want to deal with all that. I can't believe that if that were a serious possibility that he would be interested in getting involved with all that. So, no, I think his last days will be as the AD at South Carolina whenever those come.
Well, remember now, Vince Dooley was the head football coach and AD at Georgia. I understand it was a different era altogether. But, I didn't mean that in a derogatory way, but – he's had trouble finding his replacement to meet the standards. But who would be your dream coach, Phil? If you could have any coach in the country, who would you want?
For South Carolina?
Yes, sir.
Hadn't really thought that deeply about it from the standpoint of a dream coach because I don't, have any sort of connection or any sort of emotional tie to the program to have a dream about it, but just thinking, what would be fun. I'm just talking about me personally because, I know these cats and they've been successful before, but I think that, the one thing about with Coach Kingston was it was hard for him to sort of show happiness and like they're having fun. And he sort of went through a metamorphosis of a personality change over the last two or three years there compared to his first years where he was really kind of he was tight. He doesn't seem like he had a lot of fun with his players. Not sure. A lot of players didn't think he had their back. But that changed, and he changed, to his credit. That he changed, and he worked more with his players and worked more to loosen up and never criticized. He got to that point last 3 years or so. He never criticized a player for a mistake. It was all about team and family and having each other's back. Now, all that being said, me personally, and thank you for the phone call. We got to run. All right, Chris, hear me out. If I'm making the hire and I want to – this program needs a jolt of enthusiasm and excitement, right?
Mm-hmm.
So – okay, now, people will say never happened, and it probably never will, but he asked me the question, what would I do? So I'm hiring Monty Lee as the head coach and Jim Thoman as assistant head coach and recruiting coordinator, and I'm cutting them loose, and I'm saying, go get me the best ball players you can get, whatever it takes. And I guarantee you, from that aspect, they would get it done, and they would bring – some excitement and a different atmosphere to that baseball locker room. I would promise you that. That's my thoughts. Be back in a moment.
Hi,
I'm attorney Jim Corbett. That's the sound of a big hit on you and your car or truck. I've been an attorney for more than 30 years, helping people who get injured in car wrecks and truck wrecks. If you have serious injuries, call Jim Corbett, 803-765-2968, or email me at jim@jimcorbettattorney.com. That's C-O-R-B-E-T-T. I don't get paid unless I recover for you. Jim Corbett Attorney, for your best recovery from a big hit, 803-765-2968, or jim@jimcorbettattorney.com.
The South Carolina Education Lottery has introduced a new rolling jackpot, and it's big.
How big? Bigger than a striped bass?
Reel them in.
Way bigger.
Bigger than this world-class golf course?
Four.
Bigger than that.
Even bigger than the Gaffney Peach?
Let's just say with this new rolling jackpot, Palmetto Cash 5 is officially too big to ignore. Palmetto Cash 5 draws nightly, so play today and check if your numbers are winners in the Players Club app or at seeducationlottery.com.
Overall odds are 1 in 10. Top prize odds are 1 in 850,668.
Stay tuned. More Sports Talk is coming up on the Sports Talk Media Network.
Great things don't happen all at once. Big dreams take time. And when it comes to saving for college, it's those small steps that make a difference. I'm State Treasurer Curtis Loftus. Future Scholar, South Carolina's 529 College Savings Plan, is designed to be taken step by step. You can start with any amount, contributions are tax deductible, and earnings grow tax free. So why wait? Discover the smart, easy way to save for college at futurescholar.com.
George Bryant here for Tsunami Bar Sports, and some say the fun is in the winning. I say the fun is in the training. And Tsunami Robbie, what do you say?
George, we all know you get more done when you're having fun. This technology is different, it's engaging, but it's also a lot of fun to use.
Hi, this is Phil Kornblut. Be sure to click on the digital ad on sportstalksc.com and get 5% off any Tsunami Bar order using promo code BBB5. Don't wait, order today. Take a moment to remind you that summertime is here. And I talked to Jimmy Smith today just to see how he was doing. And he's doing fine. And Jimmy is ready to help you find your beachfront location for this summer's getaway. 843-237-4246. Online at paulysvacationrentals.com. Paulie's Island is the place. Jimmy is the man. So give Jimmy a call today, James W. Smith Real Estate, 843-237-4246. If you're looking to vacation just to get away and then come back home, you can do that. Or if you're looking for something more permanent, he can help you find that dream home. Ray Tanner is looking for that dream coach, and Jimmy Smith can help you find that dream home at the beach. 843-237-4246 is the number. All right, very similar, this South Carolina firing, very similar to Radakovich firing Monty Lee a few years ago, 3 years ago. And you'd have to say that that move is paying off with Eric Backich.
No doubt.
Back-to-back national seeds and now getting to a super regional for the first time. And now can they take it all the way to Omaha? We shall see coming up this weekend against Florida.
They are good enough, Phil, to get to Omaha and I think make a deep run in the College World Series. The only question I would have about Clemson is they play with fire a whole lot, whether it be waiting to come from behind in the eighth or ninth inning 25 times like they have this year, or even go back to last night, their win over Coastal. Coastal made so many mistakes in that ball game. Clemson should have led by the fifth inning about 10-0.
Mm-hmm.
And you go into the top of the eighth inning, Coastal's down 6-2. Two swings of the bat from Caden Bodine and Derek Bender, and it's 6-5. And there's no way in the world, and Gary Gilmore would tell you that afterwards, there was no reason on this earth that Coastal should have been in that game. Now, Clemson had an extra switch that they could go to, and it started with a Cannarella home run in the bottom of the eighth inning to put it away. But you start facing some teams in Omaha, and you fall 3-4 runs down, or you let them hang around too long. It may come back to bite them in the backside. But talent-wise, that's a very, very good baseball team that Clemson has.
All right, back to your phone calls, 888-898-2525, South Carolina Education Lottery lucky number, and it is Dylan?
Yes,
in Fountain Inn?
Yes, sir.
All right. Dylan, welcome in. Good to have you with us. How are you?
Yeah, it's Delvin in Fountain. I kept messing up. He couldn't get on my cell phone real good, so it's Delvin in Fountain.
Oh, this is so Delvin in Fountain Inn. I thought we made a new friend in Fountain Inn. Hello, Delvin. How are you?
I'm doing great. How you guys doing this afternoon?
We're doing fine. We're doing fine.
Yeah. First of all, class hat from everybody that's giving a shout out to Coach Gilmore after the game and showing class hat and respect. And the name I like in second line has been coming out a lot is Chris Pollard. I think across the facilities are better. And plus, I think they would have had a host regional this year, but due to their facilities, they didn't get a chance to do it. And I think he'll be happy. Of course, we know about the ACC, probably about the dissolve. He probably want to go to a different situation where he know he could be have a steady situation and coach.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. He's done a really good job at Duke and won the ACC tournament
and
championship this
too.
Year. Yep, yep. I mean, he would be a quality hire from the standpoint of there's several guys like that. The Wake Forest coach, though they had a disappointing year this year, Wake Forest coach. I mean, just look around the field of the NCAA tournament, and you can find any number of good coaches who did good work with their teams this season. What about the Evansville coach? I mean, just, you know, throw a dart at a name, at a team that's going to a super, and see if that coach might be interested. You could find a candidate that way.
Phil, I don't mean to correct you guys, but it was Grand Neff who fired Montague. It wasn't Darren Radko, it was Grand Neff.
Is that right? Was it Neff? And not Dan Rad? That's right. You're right. You're right. Dan Rad fired Jack Leggett. Yep.
Yeah.
Right. Good call. Good catch on that. Sorry about that. Let's give that credit to Graham Neff.
That's the name I was looking at. It's Pollard, and you said the guy from Wake Forest. I agree with you. Those would be two. I mean, if it's true that he got an open checkbook, like I said, somebody mentioned Kelly O'Sullivan. I agree with you. I don't think he's going to leave him in the way he got that program. I know they were 28 and 27, but, hey, he got him, like, what, two wins away from Pollard, 3 wins away from the College World Series in Omaha. So it's going to be interesting, though.
Yes, it is.
With the coaching search.
Delvin, thanks very much. Good hearing from you. Yeah, good talking to you. 888-898-2525. Are we going?
So another name out there that we can run past Kendall Rogers, because it's more of a national name, but a guy who said a tremendous amount of success, says it didn't have quite the season they're used to. Tim Tadlock at Texas Tech.
Yeah,
he's been there 10-11 years, and it's taken them to two or three College World Series. I mean, yeah, I don't know how much money he's making at Texas Tech. My guess is he's probably pretty happy out there, but you can't hurt to call these guys. Like he told, and I'm sure Ray Tanner knows all these guys, so we're not throwing names at him. He's never heard of him. Yeah,
real
kind of surprise him with the name.
Real quick, let's go to Ron in Greenville. Back to the Upstate, Ron. Welcome into Sports Talk.
Phil, I appreciate it, buddy.
Yes, sir.
I know Gamecock Larry couldn't flip snap because he got his wish.
Yeah, well, it was a double-edged sword for him. I mean, yeah, on the coaching change, but. His team also, got beat short of their goal, so it was not exactly a happy weekend for him.
Yeah, hey, man, it's great to hear from Delvin. Hadn't heard from him about 5-6 years.
Yeah.
And, of course, had a friend to come in today that was an amateur state champion, Lee Earl Jackson. Okay, hey, Phil. Let me just ask you this. I think Monty Lee would be a good coach. I think Landon Powell has enough experience to be a good coach. But I used to go watch North Greenville play and keep up for them.
Yeah. You just brought up a good point, and thank you. We got to run. Let me go back to that staff. Monty is head coach. Would Landon Powell come in as an assistant coach? Maybe more highly paid than he was at North Greenville?
To Carolina? I bet I'm sure he would consider it.
Then, of course, Jim Tomaine. All right, be right back.
Welcome back to Sports Talk on the Sports Talk Media Network. You can reach the guys with the South Carolina Education Lottery lucky number, 888-898-2525. That's 888-898-2525. Now back to Phil and Chris with a second hour of Sports Talk on the Sports Talk Media Network.
All right, welcome back, everybody. Sports Talk across the state of South Carolina. Sports Talk Media Network, Phil Kornblut, Chris Bergen, and Josh Cohen all together with you. We got recruiting coming up. Jim Thoman coming up at the bottom of the hour, just a bit outside with Jim Thoman. But staying on the hot topic of the day here in South Carolina, Mark Kingston relieved of his duties after 7 years and six seasons as head baseball coach at South Carolina. Our pleasure to welcome in from D1 Baseball, a man who covers the sport like none other nationally and is a guy who is so deeply involved in these coaching changes. It's amazing what he knows. We welcome Kendall Rogers of D1 Baseball to Sports Talk. Kendall, good to have you with us. How are you?
Yeah, man. How's it going? It's been a busy day. We got regionals. We had about 875 kids enter the transfer portal. And, oh, by the way, South Carolina decided to make a coaching change today. So it's been quite a day, to say the least.
Just to add a little something more to your day. So, like so many, I guess you sensed that something was coming down here, something was possible with South Carolina. Why do you think at the end of the day Ray Tanner decided to make this move?
Yeah, I mean, I think the biggest thing is if you look at just the South Carolina program as a whole, there's no doubt that, you know, Mark Kingston took the Gamecocks to the postseason last year. They were in a super regional 2 years ago. But I don't think anybody that would look at South Carolina's program would go, hey, this is a program that's going to consistently threaten Tennessee. They're going to consistently threaten Vanderbilt, Florida, et cetera. And I think if you're South Carolina with that rabbit of a fan base, you've got, you know, you've got that kind of ballpark at Founders Park, and you feel like you're not competing, you know, you're not really going, you're not really threatening those programs. I think you feel like you have to make a move, because the problem in the NIL era is the bigger hole you get into, the more trouble you're in. So I think Ray kind of felt like it was necessary to make a move now, because I think the time is right for them to go out and get a splashy name. You know, the last go around, you know, Mark wasn't some massive name. He was a successful coach, don't get me wrong, but he was not a huge name. I think this go around, I think they can go out and land one of these so-called big fishes.
Who would you consider a big fish that might be interested in coming to Columbia?
Yeah, you know, I think the biggest guy for me would probably be Cliff Godwin or Dan McDonald. You know, the thing I wonder about with Cliff is, you know, he's been in East Carolina for several years. He obviously, his dream is to get that program to Omaha. But, you know, if you're Cliff Godwin and you love ECU, but you know, ultimately everybody wants to coach in the SEC, you know, your time's kind of running out. Like, you don't really know when, you know, Mike Bianco is going to hang it up. It doesn't look like there's going to be a job opening anytime soon with other programs around the league. So, you know, if you're Cliff, you kind of wonder if your time's running out. And, you know, South Carolina is a place that he knows well. He knows that region in and out from a recruiting standpoint. He's been in that area before. And I think that would make a lot of sense. You know, McDonald, for me, if Dan was able to adapt to the NIL era, I think he would be a really good hire. My issue with Dan is that, you know, not to offend Clemson people at all, but he's kind of a little bit like Dabo in the sense where in college baseball, he doesn't want to use NIL. Mm-hmm. And if you're going to compete in the Southeastern Conference against those teams, you've got to dab in the NIL. So, you know, if he will change on that regard, I think that would be a great hire. So that's kind of a caveat for me. So those would be the two main ones, you know, kind of on the top of my head.
Yeah, those are two good ones for sure. We've talked about Coach Pollard at Duke as well, and, you know, some of these other successful coaches who are in programs that don't spend the money and have the facilities like South Carolina. And these are the kind of programs where you think South Carolina could go and pluck somebody. So Kingston made the comment in his post game yesterday in Raleigh about NIL and indicating that he thought maybe South Carolina wasn't doing enough for NIL to help him go out and get the players. What's your read there? Is South Carolina doing enough? It wants to play with the big boys. It wants to be a big boy again. Is South Carolina doing enough in that space?
Well, that's the thing. And he is right. Like, I know that for a fact that they are not playing in the same ballpark NIL-wise with Tennessee, Arkansas, LSU, A&M, et cetera. The reason why I know that is because one of their better players could very well end up in the portal because, you know, all these other star players are getting, you know, X amount of money and he's getting a fraction of that. Mm-hmm. So there's no question that holds you back. The problem you run into, if you're Mark, is on one hand you're saying, hey, I need all this NIL money, But if there's fatigue and there's apathy with the fan base and the donor base and they won't get that money because they just don't really support you all that much, well, then you're at a stalemate, right? Like, you know, you're not doing a terrible job, but you're not going to be able to get the players you need to get to Omaha. And so, I think that goes back to the reason why Ray made this decision, because there's donor fatigue. There's donor apathy. And so I think that's a big reason for it.
Mm-hmm.
Kendall Rogers, managing editor and writer for D1Baseball.com, our special guest here tonight, recapping the top story in the state. Mark Kingston out as head baseball coach at South Carolina. Kendall, I wanted to go back to your point about nearly 1,000 players already in to the transfer portal. Yeah. How much time does Ray Tanner, in your mind, have to make this hire so that South Carolina doesn't start, first off, losing tons of players to the portal and also maybe missing out on guys they might be able to bring in with a new head coach?
Yeah, I mean, you really, if you're South Carolina, you really got to get on the horn from an NIL perspective. I mean, I don't want to name names just because if they don't go in the portal, I don't want to get people blowing them up. But, I mean, a couple of their better players are rumored to be going to the portal, and you really got to get on that from an NIL standpoint. And you're right. I mean, with a coaching search in modern college baseball, you cannot, you know, afford to wait 2.5-3 weeks to make a decision. You know, by that time, kids have made decisions, they're in the portal, they're, you know, things are already set up and where they're going. I kind of go back to Jay Johnson, you know, last year in Omaha. You know, I'm sitting there talking to Jay in the hotel lobby. They're playing for the national championship on a Friday, and he's over there pulling his hair out, and I'm like, man, what's wrong? And he's like, well, you know, all these teams are getting guys out of the portal, and I'm here in Omaha. And he goes, I know I should be happy about playing for the national championship, but I'm also trying to land guys out of the portal. So that gives you an idea, kind of allows you to pull back the curtain on what these coaches are dealing with. So time is definitely the essence, especially at a program like Carolina, to where, you know, you want to make an immediate impact. You want to make an immediate move in this space.
He may be a touch off your radar just because he coaches at a Division II program, but my guess is you're at least familiar with Landon Powell. A lot of Gamecock fans would love to see him come back and coach at his alma mater. Is that a move for Ray Tanner that you can make them make a splashy hire because he's a former Gamecock, or is a D2 coach maybe not ready to coach in the SEC?
Yeah, I mean, I think Landon's done an incredible job, to say the least. I mean, that what he's done at that level is amazing. I just think if you're Ray and you're wanting to make a splash, I don't think you're making a splash by going and hiring someone from a different division, because you don't really know, like, how he's going to be as a Division I head coach. Like, he may be great at the D2 level or whatnot, but, I mean, you have no litmus test on what he can do at the Division I level. So, I mean, personally, like, you're probably better off, you know, with Mark Kingston, because you at least know what you're going to get, right? Like, he's at least going to get you to the postseason. Whereas Landon, it could either, you know, strike hot or, you know, it could be one of those things where in 2 years you're like, man, I got to get rid of one of my favorite players in Gamecock history because, boy, he's just not ready for this. And I just don't think Ray wants to go through that. And frankly, you cannot go through that in the SEC in its current structure.
Let me throw something radical at you. I just talked about it because somebody asked me what I, you know, felt my the dream hire would be as I think about it. And, of course, I've been around these parts a long time and have seen a lot of these coaches come and go. But if you're Ray Tanner and you know the clock is ticking on your time as AD at South Carolina and your greatest – time at South Carolina where your years as baseball coach and your two runs to the College World Series 3 years in a row in the two national championships and playing for a couple of others. So you had that great run. You know, why not bring the band back together? You got Monty Lee serving as the interim coach. He was with you when you won the second time around.
Yeah.
You've got Jim Thoman, who is available and looking for head coaching jobs. And you got Landon Powell, a young up-and-coming coach. I mean, would that coaching staff not have a little bit of wow to it from a South Carolina standpoint, or would it be looked down upon in some ways? How would that be played? How would that be viewed nationally, in your opinion?
I mean, if you were able to put that staff together, and let's say Monty was the head coach, and you're able to put that staff together, and all those, and Landon and, you know, Jim were assistants, I think that's a great pitch. I think you would have to exhaust a couple of your options to get to that point. But I mean, if that's your worst case scenario, in my opinion, I mean, that's a hell of a worst case scenario. So, I wouldn't have an issue with that. I think, you know, people will go back to the fact that Monty couldn't get through regional at Clemson, but we all know that that takes a lot of luck, man. Like, sometimes things just don't fall your way. It's not like Clemson went into games and you were like, oh, man, this looks like a horribly coached team.
Yeah.
They just had some really bad breaks. And so, yeah, I would have no issue with that option.
Last thing we'll let you go, Clemson and Florida in a super regional at Doug Kingsmore. How shocked are you, or are you shocked that Florida is still around? And B, kind of give us a quick preview of that series as you see it.
Well, I'll tell you what, I don't know who's happier about Clemson winning a regional and not having to hear about them not winning a regional, more me or Eric Backich, because, I mean, it's just been constant on my social media over the last few years. So, you know, happy for those guys. I think Eric does an awesome job. Ultimately, I think this is a series that is going to have a lot of offense, and that won't surprise you from Clemson. I mean, they've been very offensive all year long, but if you look at Florida over the weekend at Oklahoma State, whether it's Tyler Shelnut or Jack Caglione, it was big hit after big hit for Florida. They actually pitched really well today in the final game. So, you know, Florida's playing with house money. They're a team that came into the postseason. Everybody talks about how they had no business being in this field. They're going to go into this thing all chips in. They're going to have no pressure. And the pressure, to some extent, will be on Clemson. But guess what? The pressure was on Clemson in the game against Coastal Carolina, and they still took care of business in pretty impressive fashion. But circle Jack Caglione and circle Cam Cannarella. Man, those two guys are going to put on an absolute show this weekend.
I mean, look, I know Florida had a crummy overall regular season record. Barely got into the tournament, I guess. But they're still Florida, and you just mentioned a couple of studs. I mean, they have talent up and down their lineup and in their pitching staff still. I don't know why they struggled so much in the regular season. Maybe you have some insight on that, but they're still Florida, and you have to respect them.
There's no doubt, man. Those guys are just made for the postseason. You know, the regular season of them is just kind of a sideshow a little bit. And so the biggest thing for Florida is they were extremely inconsistent on the mound. Throughout the year, they, you know, offensively, they relied way too much on the long ball at times. I mean, if you go back and look at the numbers, I want to say like 59 or 60 of their home runs that they've hit this year as a team are solo shots. So they haven't been able to, you know, until this weekend, they haven't been able to get guys on base for those home runs. And so, you know, hey, a team will let you get a solo home run two or three times a game all day long as there's not multiple guys on base. So the big key for Clemson going into the weekend is going to be, hey, if Caglione or Shelnut or Colby Shelton's at the plate, we need to make sure nobody's on base in front of them. If we do that, I think we're in pretty good shape.
Mm-hmm.
Kendall Field did not realize I had one more question, so if you'll beg my difference just a second.
For it,
I
man.
Did want to ask you, since you brought them up, about Coastal Carolina and Gary Gilmore retiring after last night's loss to Clemson. Coach Gilmore was asked about pay for play in the current state of college baseball, and he's basically part of the reason he's getting out is he doesn't want to deal with it anymore. Their run as a mid-major program back in 2016, are we to the point now in your mind that that kind of run for a school like Coastal can never happen again?
I think it can. I mean, if you look around the country, I mean, hey, the Sun Belt, I mean, this would be my argument to Gary is his own, you know, I think Gary made great points. Don't get me wrong. But I think my argument to counter Gary a little bit is, like, look at the rise of the Sun Belt right now. Like, Troy's getting astronomically better as a program. You know, Georgia Southern, Rodney Hinton's, you know, program continues to do a nice job. Louisiana has done a really nice job. JMU is a really good team this year. So, on one hand, yeah, like NIL and things like that can be a detriment to mid-majors. But you know what? Out of all the players in college baseball, there's a lot of kids, man, who either are in a mid-major, they're not playing quite as much as they want to, a power school, they're not playing quite as much as they want to. They want to put a mid-major. And frankly, there's a lot of kids out there that look at a program like Coastal Carolina with cachet and go, hey, you know what? Actually, I don't really want to go to, you know, I don't want to go to whatever, you know, Kentucky. Like, I want to go to Coastal Carolina. Like, I love that tradition. So, thankfully, Coastal's kind of built that. So, I think they'll be fine. But, I mean, I do think he has a point that, like, some of the really small mid-majors, it's going to be a little bit of a tougher to hoe in the current landscape. You know, I think we're looking at a future in college baseball of having 27 to 30 roster spots. All of those spots being, you know, full scholarship. Mm. And I honestly never thought I'd live to see the day that college baseball is full scholarship. But that will end up being an issue for mid-majors because what you'll end up having, you'll have a cap to play Division One baseball. It might be at 16. I'm hearing it could be at 18. But imagine being a team that's got 16 scholarships and you're over here competing at South Carolina with 30. We're just getting started on some of the issues that may creep into the sport.
Yep, a lot of stuff to iron out, and we thank you for the time. I know you're extremely busy, still got more baseball to watch tonight, and then on to the Supers this weekend. We appreciate your coverage and what you do at D1 Baseball, and we thank you for joining us tonight. We'll talk again.
Thanks, Kendall.
You got it, buddy. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Guys. Kendall Rogers, D1 Baseball. Appreciate him being on with us tonight. Matt Smith actually arranged that for us. Yeah. Smitty makes friends very easily.
I don't know if he's a likable guy.
Pays people to be friends with him, but yeah, he hooked up with Kendall at the, and also Aaron Fitt. Is it Aaron Fitt? Aaron Fitt.
Aaron Fitt. Correct.
Yeah, works there with him, and he got with him at the ACC tournament, so they became buddies, BFFs, and he arranged that for us. Be right back.
Hi, this is Billy Downer from the South Carolina Department of Natural Resources. Are you looking for a safe place to shoot your rifle or handgun? Did you know that the South Carolina Department of Natural Resources operates 4-man ranges across the state in Pickens County, Spartanburg County, Richland County, and Charleston County? For more information on our public ranges, visit dnr.sc.gov/shooting.
You've put in the work for your education. The extra early, extra late, extra, extra work. That's because you understand education opens doors to better pay, better opportunities, and a better you. Being educated about playing the lottery is no different. It helps you be a better player, one who knows when to play and when to take a rain check. The lottery's a game, so let's keep it fun. Learn more at sceducationlottery.com/betteryou.
You're listening to Sports Talk on the Sports Talk Media Network. We're back in a moment.
Relax this summer with a promotional rate on select travel purchases with your Founders Federal Credit Union credit card. Now through August 31st, get 6.99% APR for 6 months on qualifying purchases, including airfare, hotels, restaurants, and cruise lines. Don't let interest rates slow you down this summer. Visit foundersfcu.com/travel to learn more. Not a Founders member yet? Founders has the financial tools you need and the personalized service you deserve. Stop by an office or visit foundersfcu.com to learn more about Founders and see if you qualify for membership. On March 1st, 2025, the promotional APR will revert to the effective APR as previously disclosed. Call 800-845-1644 for details about credit costs and terms. Membership qualification required.
The Sports Talk Recruiting Report is sponsored by Seawells Catering.
Man, what a voice. What pipes. You gotta give me some pipes like that.
Seawells. Brought to you by Seawells.
All right, it is time for recruiting, brought to you by Seawells. Back open tomorrow for the daily lunch and buffet. Make your plans to get over and enjoy every day during the week. Tuesday through Friday, my goal is to get to Seawells at least once this week, hopefully for a roast beef. Yeah, I may be at Clemson on Friday.
Well, it's not a roast beef Friday.
Yeah, it's what?
It is beef tips and mushroom gravy Friday.
Well, when is roast beef what? What day is roast beef? Just pure roast beef.
I got to say, I don't see it here on their menu. Oh. So that's a hard week for
us. Taking
a
week off.
Yeah. Tomorrow's lasagna, southern fried chicken, and carved applewood ham.
That's plenty of good reason to get there. And for the best in the catering business, that's Seawells as well. Their phone number is 803-771-7385, online at seawellscateringsc.com. So, South Carolina Clemson had official visitors over the weekend. Let's give you the names once again of players who were in or scheduled to be in for the two programs at USC. Athlete A.J. Brand, they like him as a safety. Offensive center, Isaac Soles. Defensive tackle, Caleb Williams. Offensive tackle, Jalen Gilchrist. Offensive tackle, Cortez Smith. Defensive end, Tayshawn Alston. Linebacker, Jaden Breaker. Offensive guard, Dontrell Glover. Running back, Jeffrey Overton. Receiver, Winston Watkins. Defensive end, Jared Smith. Receiver, Malik Clark. And safety, Jadon Blair. Williams is already committed, so I really should not have mentioned him. These were uncommitted recruits who were in. For Clemson, Offensive tackle David Sanders. Defensive end Bryce Davis. Defensive tackle Christian Garrett. And safety Jordan Young. Safety Anquan Fagans. Offensive tackles Mal Waldrop, Mario Nash. Linebacker Kamar Archie. Receiver Samari Reed. Receiver Cortez Mills. Offensive guard Max Buchanan. Offensive tackle Hardy Watts is still there, came in Sunday. Cornerback Donovan Starr. Offensive tackle Rowan Byrne. Defensive tackle Walter Mathis. And cornerback Grayson Littleton. He arrived today. Couple of notes on official visitors. Christian Garrett of Bogart, Georgia at Clemson. And he said the part that stuck out the most to him was how close everybody is at Clemson. They talked about a plan for him where he would play all over on the defensive front. Clemson's been a factor with him and remains so after this official visit weekend. Tigers really strengthened their position with him. He's going to announce on July 20th, and he has visits coming up this month with Georgia, Georgia Tech, and Tennessee the next three weekends. Then he'll take time out to make his decision. For South Carolina, safety Jadon Blair, 6'4", 180, out of North Carolina. And he really had a great time on his visit. He really likes Shane Beamer. He likes Torian Gray. He's also made officials to Virginia Tech and Louisville. Did so in April. And South Carolina has been recruiting him very hard. He loved the environment, the hospitality. And they took him and the other recruits, broke down some film of them, and then compared their film with some of the players they have at their respective positions so they could see kind of where they are and where they could get to. I think that's a pretty smart move on their part, and he really enjoyed seeing that. So the competition here is very tough, but he said South Carolina is very much in the mix. He's got four more visits, Notre Dame on the 11th, Michigan on the 14th, Florida State on the 18th, and Penn State on the 21st. He will announce on July 5th. You win that kind of contest, you've picked up a good one. Offensive guard Dontrell Glover, Fairburn, Georgia, went to South Carolina over the weekend, and he has set July 1st for his commitment announcement. Georgia, Florida State, Tennessee also high up on his list, and he has an official to Florida State on June 21st. Let's see, what else? USC offered defensive tackle Trayshawn Ruffin, 6'4", 305, Calypso, North Carolina, 2026 athlete Mac Sutter, 6'6", 225, Dunlap, Illinois, 2027 quarterback Champ Smith, 6'1", 180 of Miami. Clemson, several 2026 offers. Safety, Zaylus Hicks, Carrollton, Georgia. Offensive tackle, Leo Delaney of Charlotte. Athlete, Jamarian Gordon of Jackson, Alabama, an Alabama commit. Safety, Xavier Larisi of Melbourne, Florida. Offensive tackle, Ikini Oboko of Durham. Linebacker Thomas Davis Jr., Matthews, North Carolina, son of the former Panther. Offensive tackle Maxwell Riley of Avon Lake, Ohio. Offensive guard and center Grant Wise of Pace, Florida. Offensive tackle Darius Gray of Richmond. Cornerback Jazavian Currents of South Point. Safety Inari White, Riverdale, Georgia. And linebacker Tyler Atkinson of Lawrenceville, Georgia. Some other notes. Rock Hill wide receiver Malik Clark set an official to Florida State June 14th. He was at USC over the weekend. He has North Carolina this weekend and then NC State on the 21st. Cornerback Onis Konanbani of Heathwood Hall made an official to Florida State over the weekend. He has North Carolina, Penn State, Tennessee coming up. Offensive guard Gavin Blanchard of Tampa, who visited Clemson for the Notre Dame game last season and for a junior day in January, but was not offered by the Tigers, committed to UCF. 2026 offensive tackle Desmond Green of Timberland. Camp stops Clemson June 4th and USC June 17th. Among his travels in June, other camp stops will be Auburn, Alabama, LSU, Georgia, North Carolina, NC State, and Tennessee. And we got a few more notes that we will get to for you after this break on Sports Talk. We'll be right back. Don't you cry no more. All right, just a couple of more recruiting notes, and then to Coach Jim Thoman, Another offer from Clemson that went out on June 1st when the Tigers offered a bunch of 2026 guys. Jordan Carter, a defensive end from Douglasville, Georgia, 6'4", 235. So put him on the list of players offered by Clemson. A couple of other notes. 2026 quarterback Brody McWhorter has Clemson down for a camp tomorrow. He'll follow that stop with camps at North Carolina, Auburn, Alabama, Georgia, and Ohio State. Blythewood defensive tackle Sterling Sanders plans to camp at USC June 14th. He's also got NC State, Florida, Georgia Tech, Virginia, North Carolina, Alabama coming up. 2026 receiver Jordan Gidron of Ridgeview was at Auburn Saturday. Former Gamecock defensive end Terrell Dawkins is transferring to North Texas. Wide receiver Shamar Foles of Miami committed to Coastal Carolina. And former Tennessee corner Christian Conyer transferring to Coastal Carolina. Women's basketball note, USC in the top 10 with 2026, 6'3", Olivia Edwards of Tacoma, Washington, with North Carolina, Florida State, Tennessee, Washington, Florida, Duke, LSU, Southern Cal, and Notre Dame. There you go. That, my friends, recruiting on this Monday night.
Just a bit outside. He tried the corner and missed.
All right, time to welcome into the ring, simply known as the big guy, Coach Jim Thoman, just a bit outside. What a day. What a weekend.
How you guys doing tonight?
How we doing? Okay, so somebody asked me my dream coaching staff for South Carolina. You want to hear it? My dream coaching staff for South Carolina. You ready?
Sure, go ahead.
Head coach Monty Lee.
Okay.
Yeah.
Good call.
Yeah. Assistant head coach, recruiting coordinator, Jim Thoman.
Yeah, and just all around nice guy.
Yeah, absolutely. And associate head coach, offensive coordinator, for lack of better terms, Landon Powell. Huh?
So you're gonna put Landon over Jim Thoman? Wow.
No, associate. Which is higher.
Associate has more cachet.
That's what I used to be. That means I'd probably be a little older than Landon.
Well, that's whatever. We'll do it by the age.
Landon and his wife Allie were babysitters for my three kids, so I would be the associate head.
We're not getting caught up in titles here. And then now pitching coach, you know, we'll have to figure that out for you. I don't think either you or Landon can teach anybody how to pitch, really. So,
shoot, I was an underrated pitching coach for Coach Tanner at NC State, but you just keep Matt Williams right there. We can bring Jerry Myers in, or we could bring in all kinds of different guys. We got Will Dorton over there in Charleston. We got Forrest Arnold at North Carolina A&T. We know a lot of good pitching coaches.
All right, so why would Ray Tanner do that? Why would Ray Tanner not do that?
I don't know. I haven't talked to the guy in a while. I usually talk to him quite a bit, but he got a little quiet there, so I figured there was something going on. But I wanted to shout out to Coach Kingston. I mean, the guy gave his heart and soul for 7 years, and you know, at times was looking like really, really good, and then they'd stumble or get hurt or just not quite get to Omaha. It's very difficult to get there, and you know, Chad did a nice job when he was here. Just they couldn't get over the hump, and they couldn't quite get to Omaha, but their numbers are pretty darn good. It's just when you got to get hot late and finish strong, and you've got to really play your best baseball in the postseason. I think that's why Coach Tanner was so good. He'd still have the guys strong late in the year, and we seem to always make runs. And I guess it's been 12, 13 years since we've been to Omaha, and I think Coach Tanner went like 6 out of his last 12 years. But, you know, you got Monty Lee sitting right there in that desk as the interim. That wouldn't be a bad call at all because Monty's older now. He's wiser. He's been a head coach at 2 different places. I mean, there ain't nothing wrong with that in my mind.
No, I agree. I mean, if I'm Ray Tanner, you got to, yeah, it'd be, you know, you can go outside and hire a guy and he can bring in his people or outside people and you can flush everything that, you know, went on before. You did that. You tried that. You've tried it both ways. You've tried with an inside guy with Chad Holbrook. You've tried it with an outside guy with Mark Kingston. You know, I would think if I were Tanner, man, I would try to get the band back together again for one last run at it. I mean, and maybe Tanner does like Jack Leggett. He starts hanging around the baseball operation, maybe puts the uniform on, hangs around in the dugout like Jack does. You know, y'all
maybe
could
we need to get him to throw BP a little bit.
Yeah.
He threw every day for about the 11 years I was there and the 6 hours or 7 hours with him at NC State. He threw every day for like 18 years. I don't know if he can throw BP anymore, but maybe he ought to get on out there.
Let me ask you a serious question.
Sure.
Now, I mean, you guys, your first run with South Carolina, the three straight trips to the World Series, and then when Monty was there, they had the second run, and they won a couple of national championships and played for another.
Yeah.
So you built something quite special, and the fans want to get back to that. Now, this is a different era of baseball. Teams are across the country are pouring money into it. The NIL space has become part of it, and a lot of teams are making that effort there. Maybe South Carolina hasn't been making the same effort through an NIL operation to get the kind of players to get you back to elite status. So my question to you is it reasonable for the fans to expect the same success now that they enjoyed during that very special time between like early 2000 through 2012, those 12, 13 years there? Is it reasonable to expect South Carolina to get back to that?
You know what, as a coach, I love the expectations. I love the fans wanting to go to Omaha. Yeah, the times have changed a little bit with the NIL and the portal and stuff, but I'm sure, you know, we probably at South Carolina need to figure out a way to use some of that NIL money and see how much. I don't know how much they have. I have no idea. I don't know how much LSU has. I don't know how much Clemson has. It's very difficult. But, you know, one of the reasons that Kingston was let go was you know, he was 37-25 with a 22 RPI. Well, the expectations are so high because of the bar that Coach Tanner set. You know, you're talking about winning two national titles and going to Omaha six times in 12 years. There were three other in-state schools that unfortunately let go of their coaches this year. One was a 241 RPI, one was a 197 RPI, and one was a 232 RPI. The other three schools, Charleston Southern let go of their coach today, and Winthrop has been open, and the Citadel has been open. But you're talking about really high RPIs, and you got a guy at South Carolina that gets a 22 RPI for the year out of 305 teams, and he was let go, and it's because of the bar that Coach Tanner set, and it's really hard to match up with that. That being said, you know, like all the South Carolina fans, I would love for the Gamecocks to go to Omaha. I would love to recruit at Omaha, but, you know, there's not many jobs open. And we don't know who Coach Tanner has in mind. I think he'll get a big name. If he doesn't, you got Monty sitting right there that is ready to go. And I don't know who Monty would hire, but I kind of like your staff, Phil. That's a pretty
well.
You're smarter than you look.
I know that. Staff. Let's put it on the record. Let's break news here. Let's tell Kendall Rogers to write
it
up. Is Jim Thoman saying he would return to South Carolina in some capacity if given the opportunity?
Well, Phil, I mean, I was there for 11 years. I went to Omaha 3 years with the Gamecocks. And the other three, I helped recruit all them guys, Michael Roth and Wingo and Merrifield and them guys. So I had a little bit of a hand in the other three. But I'm in Florida right now with the palm trees around me, getting ready to watch my son Tucker for 6 days playing pro ball.
Mm-hmm.
That being said, it's probably a 9-hour drive to Columbia. I'd probably be there in six if someone called me. I would get there quick.
Well, now listen, you need to be careful driving, if you know what I mean. You need to watch your speed.
That's true. I got to watch that. I can't be outside the lines, right?
That's exactly right. Jim Thoman with us just a bit outside. All right. So in all seriousness, no matter what direction he moves in, how is this something that needs to be expedited? Or does Tanner want to? Does he wait until after the World Series to see what?
I'm sure he probably has already been looking for a while, just in case. You know, if South Carolina would have went to Super or Omaha, then you don't worry about it. But ADs always do things in advance, so he probably has a few guys in mind, and you know, it might be guys that already have great jobs, and or it might be guys that want to come, or it could be close to being done. I have no idea. There's a lot of good coaches out there, but you really need to get someone in here. We need to go back to Omaha, and yeah, it would help if we could get some more NIL money. I don't know how much the athletic department has. I'm not there, but that helps in recruiting. That being said, if you evaluate properly and you work your butt off and you work harder than all these guys, you can get some really good players. But look at LSU, for instance. They paid for Tommy Tanks, and they already had Dylan Cruz as a recruit, and then they paid for Skeens. They had the two top players in the country, and what did they do? Well, they won a national title.
Mm-hmm.
So that's a perfect example of what NIL money can do to you. Now they have a great program and a great history, but you know, if Coach Tanner can get Skip Bertman to come out of retirement, or Coach Tanner takes over the program himself, that would be two guys I would be for. Other than that, you know, you got Monty right there. Maybe he's got something, you know, the bird in the hand. You got him right there, ready to go. You don't want to take too much time on the hire. The portal opened today, and there's about 30 pitchers throwing about 95. Now, I don't know if they can get anyone out, but there's some good arms on that portal. And there's something like 500 or 600 that went in there today. It's absolutely going crazy. So
all right,
the sooner he gets a coach in place, the better. You don't want to waste time in recruiting. And you got to recruit your recruits over again after the draft. And you got to try to keep your players that are there. There's a lot of things that have to be done, so the sooner he can get a head coach in there, a permanent head coach, the better off the Gamecocks will be, in my opinion.
Yeah.
I'm not a guru, you know.
No, you're guru-ish.
I'm not a guru athletic director. I'm a guru ex-recruiter that wants to get back to Omaha, but, you know, I don't know the ins and outs of all that stuff with athletic directors, but I would assume the faster they get a really good coach in there, or a head coach permanent and knows he's in there, the better the recruiting would go.
All right.
And that's the lifeblood of any program. No matter what you say, you can coach them up all you want, you got to get good players.
All right, now,
great players.
You mentioned Charleston Southern. I should mention that Mark McMillan will not return. He was let go today, 86-116 in four seasons there. But I want to mention this, too, going back to the Gamecocks. So, obviously, mm-hmm. their number one recruit is P.J. Morlando, from down in Charleston area, Somerville. He put out a tweet thanking Coach Kingston for the opportunity to play at South Carolina. Wish you the best. He wrote, Monty Lee was a huge factor in my decision in signing with South Carolina. I can think of no one better to be the next head coach of the Gamecocks. How much, you know, and this guy's a great player, right? He was named the Gatorade Player of the Year in South Carolina, hit close to 400, on base more than 60% of the time. How much weight, if you're Ray Tanner, you hear that from a star player, if you think you're going to get him into school, unless he obviously is going to be an early draft pick, I guess. I mean, how do you react to that if you're Tanner?
Well, number one, it shows Monty's character and how much the players like Monty and how much the recruits like him in the recruiting process. So that's always a plus, that kids are fighting for Monty. That is awesome. You know, in that case, that kid may be a first rounder. He may never, ever show up. But if he comes because of Monty, then that would be awesome. We want that kid at South Carolina. The kid's a stud hitter, left-handed hitter. But you don't know, you know, what's going to happen in the draft until July. So hard to figure. But, yeah, them things like that, it's good that the recruits are pulling for him, and I'm happy for Monty that way. And Coach Tanner will take everything into consideration, and he wants to do what's best for the program. And it isn't like the last two coaches. You know, I know the fans were upset we didn't get to Omaha, but Chad Holbrook's a heck of a coach and Mark Kingston's a heck of a coach. But at South Carolina, you've got to be a Ray Tannerish, Jack Leggett, Gary Gilmore, Skip Bertman, and Ozzie Garrido.
you got to be a Garrido. You got to be really good. Mm. So we got to get back to Omaha and get these fans that haven't been back for 12 years, get them back there. That's got to be on the coach's mind every single day when they get up and get there. I remember Mike McGee telling me, you get every damn player in the state of South Carolina, and every day when you spend your first 15 minutes figuring out how to beat Clemson. Hmm. And I love that. So that's what I did the first 15 minutes every day, is figure out how we're going to beat Clemson, how I out-recruit them. And then, you know, eventually we started going to Omaha and making it happen. And but that's got to be the mindset. We got to get the program back where it belongs. And it's going to happen eventually. But like you said, it's a different time now. And it's a little bit harder to get there without the new rules and the money, without the NIL money and the portal and that stuff. It's a little bit different. I went out and out recruited people. I felt like I outworked people. Well, now, you know, if they pay them $100,000 and I only have $50,000, then, you know, where are they going to go?
Yeah.
So it's a little bit of a different ball game. That being said, there's 8 schools that still go to Omaha every year. And so it's possible to get there. And, you know, Monty's there right now, probably in the office still trying to figure out who's coming, who's going, who we getting in the portal. I think they got someone today. But you got to get about – you got to get about 5 or 6 grad transfers. You got to get another 5 or 6 portal guys. And then you got to keep your high school grads and from the draft. Then you got to keep your own players from the draft. It's a big process. And, you know, Monty has his hands full right now. I know him and Coach Williams and Coach Holcomb are probably just buzzing in there trying to keep up, but especially not knowing what's going to happen. But I can't speak for Coach Tanner, but I know he's a great baseball guy and he'll figure out the best possible scenario. And
did you say they got one out of the portal today, or they had one go in? I know they had a couple of pitchers go in, lightly used pitchers over the weekend.
It was on Twitter that they got a kid. They got a pitcher today. You guys gotta keep, you know, I know you've been spending a lot of time on football recruiting.
Yeah.
They got one today. Also, LaSalle is bringing back their baseball program, and Dave Miller, who used to be a Clemson player, big, strong, left-handed hitter that I recruited out of Philadelphia, he's going back to LaSalle from Manhattan College, which is Division I. Scott Wingo's at Manhattan College, mm-hmm. is one of the assistants. So that had a little bit of a Clemson, South Carolina flavor. But LaSalle, if you don't recall, during COVID, they shut down their program. It was like, I think it was 2021. Well, now supposedly they're bringing it back.
Is Wingo going with him or going to stay?
Well, I don't know. You're going to have to call Scott.
Yeah.
I can only give you certain leads, and you guys got to fit. You know,
we want you to do all our work.
You got to get Chris or Josh to figure it out. I got to go over to Hooters tonight or go to a pizza. I think I'm going to take Tucker to Outback Steakhouse tonight and get a ribeye.
Who's buying? Tucker's got all that bonus money, doesn't he?
Well, put it this way. I will not bring my wallet into the steakhouse. And I'll say, oh, I forgot my wallet in the car. And Tucker, because he loves his dad, will say, oh, Dad, I got it. Don't worry. But, no, I ain't paying for it.
Yeah.
Not tonight.
Let's see here. I'm looking to see if I can find that base. That, you don't know the guy's name off the top of your head?
I think it's from Winthrop. Caleb Jones, maybe.
Okay. Caleb does. Okay. So I guess
I think he had decent numbers, and you know, I don't know, he probably throws 94 like everyone on the portal. The key is, you know, getting guys that throw hard and have great numbers and really know how to pitch. That's the key. But I want to say,
does he spell that with a K or a C?
I think it's a C. Okay. But man, I was driving 17 hours while I'm looking at this stuff. I drove from Pittsburgh, PA. I was up at Buffalo the Clown's house.
I see.
And now I'm in Jupiter, Florida.
Caleb,
you know?
Caleb Jones, 6'4". Now, I tell you what, and we got to touch on Clemson in Florida. The kid that really, and you know, I have no eye for baseball talent. You know, I watch it like everybody else.
Sure.
But the pitcher that impresses me, and I don't know why he didn't pitch more this year, and he appears to have the strongest arm, is the McCreary kid, Connor McCreary. This guy has a smooth motion, and the ball just seems to explode out of his hands, 94, 95 consistently. Yet, I know the batting average against was very small. He did a good job there. But then again, you know, in some tough situations, he gave up some runs and some hits. What about that kid? You know what I'm talking about? He's a big, tall kid.
Yeah, I mean, you'd have to talk Coach Williams, and you usually go at the hot pitchers and guys that you trust a little bit. And sometimes new guys, you don't quite have a full trust for them. And, you know, this kid may be a stud in the future, and he's had some good outings and some bad outings, and maybe he has a tad wild, but he does throw hard and have a good arm. I'm not sure, you know. At times the pitching looked great, and other times it didn't look so good, and I just thought that South Carolina didn't quite – they didn't know who their 1, 2, 3, and 4 guys were, and the midweek guys and the setup guys and the closer seemed like it was changing a lot. But usually you'd like to get in some type of a rhythm during the season so you have an idea in the postseason what you're going to do.
Yeah.
But it just didn't work out, and that happens a lot in college baseball.
Yeah.
So.
Go ahead, Chris.
And, Phil, I think he was victimized like many other pitchers for USC, the lack of defense behind him. He had 7 unearned runs. He only gave up 11 earned runs this season when he was in the ballgame. But if you can't play defense behind him, you know, Coach, how good is your pitching when you're as porous defensively as the Gamecocks were, especially down the stretch?
That's a great point. And you know what? It was way too many errors at the tournament and just too many errors, you know, not all the time, but it really showed its ugly head at the SEC tournament, even though the Gamecocks won 3 games.
Uh-huh.
But they had a ton of errors at the tournament. And it's not really unlike Coach Kingston's team. They've played pretty good defense. But I want to say they fielded very similar, you know, to Clemson. I want to say they fielded like I think Clemson fielded this year 968, and I saw it the other day in South Carolina, despite having a lot of them errors at the tournament, I think they fielded 970. So they fielded a little bit better than Clemson, believe it or not. Now, the earned run average I looked at here, Clemson had a 445, and South Carolina had a 509. And then offensively, Clemson hit 299, South Carolina hit 276, but they both hit about the same number of home runs. South Carolina had 101, Clemson had 103, and they're still playing.
And I got
too many strikeouts for South Carolina, but as far as runs scored all year, Clemson had 467 and South Carolina had 461, so there's not much difference in the offense.
Right. We got 1 minute. 1 minute.
Okay.
Clemson now and Florida. What do you think about the Gators making it through Oklahoma State and going to Clemson?
Well, you got to give credit to Coach O'Sullivan because they were under 500 part of the year,
mm-hmm.
and they barely made it into the SEC tournament. They were 13-17, and they had to really work to get to 13-17, and they didn't even know if they were going to get in. Now, everyone knew they were a good enough team to be in a regional, but they played the number one schedule in the country. They played a lot of tough teams, and they didn't win. This is an unusual year for Coach O'Sullivan. He usually wins 40, 50 games a year. And I want to say they're like 28 and 27. And so, but, you know, kudos to him. Now, he's going back to Clemson. Zach Leggett's in the dugout. Backett is in the dugout. You got, you know, Monty Lee over here at South Carolina. You got all these Clemson guys. And now you got O'Sullivan going back. So, you know, I'm waiting for John Pawlowski to show up and throw a bullpen down there or something, but
all right.
It's going to be great. And Tim Corbin came back. Now, it was not a Clemson, you know, that didn't go good for Tim.
Nope.
But he was back at Clemson too. So it's been kind of like a big reunion for them Clemson guys. And I heard it was a really, really great environment. And
all right.
Clemson
did a really nice
job.
We are out of time, big guy. Talk to you during the week. We appreciate it. Have a great week.
Okay, guys. Have fun.
Thank you, Coach Jim Thoman, just a bit outside. Thank you, Chris. Have a good night.
Yes, sir.
Thank you, Josh, and thanks to all of you. We'll see you tomorrow.